Hachette Audio presents
How to Ride a Dragon's Storm by Cressida Cowell. Read by David Tennant. About Hiccup. Hiccup Horrendous Haddock III was an awesome sword fighter, a dragon whisperer, and the greatest Viking hero that ever lived. But Hiccup's memoirs look back to when he was a very ordinary boy, and finding it hard to be a hero. The Curse of Bear Cub's Grandmother. A long time ago, a small boy was dreaming. He was dreaming of running through the beautiful white wilderness that was his childhood home. Running and running through snow, so perfect you could hardly bear to touch it. But suddenly, his legs grew tired and so heavy he could hardly move them. Something was pulling him back. What was it? And then he awoke and opened his eyes, and he was about as far from home as he could possibly be, lying in the darkness below the decks of a great ship. The boy was called Bear Cub. He belonged to a people called the Northern Wanderers, and he had not always been a slave. Only 2 weeks before, he had had miles and miles of glorious icy desert to play in, as free as the polar bears and seals that his people harpooned to eat and keep them warm. But then the Vikings came. They had surprised the wanderers by attacking while they were asleep, dragging them aboard their Viking ships and taking them away from their homeland. Since that time, Bear Cub had not had a proper meal, and worse still, for a boy full of fidgets and used to running, he hadn't taken more than a couple of steps. Bear Cub's father had been out on a hunting party when the Vikings struck, so he had not been captured.
"Please, father," Bear Cub whispered into the blackness. "Save me, father."
"Heh!" rasped the doom-filled, furious voice of Bear Cub's scary grandmother, who was lying chained beside him.
"Your father cannot rescue you, for he does not know where you are. And the gods must have forgotten us to let this happen.
Vikings are vermin, every single one of them," she spat into the darkness. "I never met a good one. Murderous, wicked, evil people. Oh, if I had one here, I would do such things. I could eat their livers, I really could. I am cursing this voyage and everyone aboard this ship."
"We are aboard this ship," Bear Cub pointed out. "Do not curse this voyage or you may be dooming us too."
"You do not contradict your elders and betters," cried his grandmother sternly.
It is not pleasant to be changed to a cursing grandmother.
"We are doomed already. No, the only thing left for us now is to hate and to curse."
And so Bear Cub's grandmother had all of the wanderers hating and cursing and wanting to eat people's livers, baying out their fury in the rocking darkness below the decks of the ship.
"You better watch your step up there,"
screamed Bear Cub's grandmother, howling up at the ceiling like a wolf.
"If one of you misses your footing and falls down that hatch, I'm telling you, we'll tear you apart."
Only Bear Cub was quiet. And in the blackness, no one could see the tears slowly rolling down his cheeks. Which was lucky, because wanderers have the hearts of polar bears, and they do not cry. And inside his head, he repeated over and over again,
"Please, father, please help me. Please, gods, please, please help me. Please, anybody, if you're listening, help me. Help me. Help me."
One, a proper Viking swimming race.
One chilly spring day in the barbaric archipelago, Hiccup Horrendous Haddock III, the hope and heir to the tribe of the Hairy Hooligans, was standing miserably on the west beach of the murderous mountains with absolutely nothing on but his helmet, his sword, his waistcoat and a teeny-weeny pair of hairy swimming trunks. The murderous mountains were not the kind of place you wanted to visit at the best of times. They gave Hiccup the shivers, tall, cruel-looking, dizzyingly high peaks that were home to some unspeakably dangerous dragons and mutant wolves, not to mention the murderous tribe, the fiercest and most ruthless Vikings in the uncivilized world. The murderous tribe did not often receive visitors. Perhaps it was their uncomfortable habit of sacrificing unwelcome intruders to the sky dragons at the point of Mount Murderous that kept people at bay. But on this occasion, Madguts the Murderous had taken it into his head to be hospitable and to invite two of the other tribes, the Hooligans and the Bog Burglars, over to his island for a jolly little inter-tribal friendly swimming race. It was a traditional Viking swimming race, and the Vikings were a little bit crazy, so they were going swimming with their weapons on, swords, axes, daggers, that sort of thing. It did not seem to have occurred to them that this would make them less floaty. So there they were. The entire warrior populations of the murderous Hooligan and Bog Burglar tribes hopping up and down on the uncomfortable shingle beach, trying to pretend they weren't freezing their horns off, with mutant wolves howling cheeringly up in the mountains above. There was a strong easterly wind that brought goosebumps to Hiccup's skinny, freckled arms and whisked off helmets, cloaks and swords and sent them bowling briskly down the beach. Hiccup's tiny hunting dragon, Toothless, was having difficulty flying without being blown away. Toothless was a particularly small common or garden dragon with large, innocent, green-gauge eyes.
"Toothless wouldn't go swimming today if Toothless was you," he advised Hiccup. "It's very chilly in there. Toothless has been in already and it nearly froze Toothless's wings off."
"Yes, thank you, Toothless," said Hiccup. Hiccup was one of the very few Vikings before or since who could speak Dragonese, the language in which the dragons speak to each other. "Very helpful. I'll bear that in mind." Gobber the Belch, the teacher in charge of the pirate training program on Berk, had stripped down to his smalls and was breathing in the gale as if it were the loveliest of summer breezes.
"Lovely swimming weather!"
he roared delightedly, beating his chest with his fist like a great red-headed gorilla.
"Gather round and stand to attention, boys, and I'll explain the rules of the race."
The 12 boys stood before their teacher in a shivering line.
"Now, boys," boomed Gobber, "a proper Viking swimming race is not like those pathetic little competitions they carry out on the mainland. It is a test of your endurance, your strength, and your suicidal bravery."
"Oh, brother," moaned Hiccup's best friend, Fishlegs, who was the only boy on the programme who was even worse than Hiccup at all the Viking activities.
He had legs as limp as two strings of spaghetti, and he couldn't swim.
"I don't like the sound of this."
"In a proper Viking swimming race," continued Gobber, "the winner is the person who is last."
There were gasps of surprise and, "Oh, sir, please, sir, that can't be right, sir," from the line of boys.
"In which case,"
sneered Snot-Face Snotlout, a great bullying brute of a boy whose muscly arms were covered entirely in skeleton tattoos,
"Hiccup the Useless will win, no problem. He's always the last at everything."
Hiccup stood on one leg, tried to smile, and fell over in the sand.
"Aha!"
grinned Gobber, his beard bristling with keenness. He laid one finger to his nose.
"But think carefully about this, boys. We all set out from the beach and start swimming, and from then on it's a game of chicken. Who can swim out the furthest, the longest, into the deepest ocean and still return? Many are the warriors over the centuries who in their pride have misjudged the swim back and who have drowned as a consequence."
"Oh, yippee," moaned Fishlegs.
"But on the plus side, anyone who drowns in the course of a swimming race will automatically go straight to Valhalla,"
smiled Gobber, in the manner of someone giving everybody a great big birthday present.
"Oh,"
exclaimed the boys in a pleased way.
"Mad," groaned Fishlegs, swaying in the wind like a small skinny tree about to snap. We are the only sane people in a tribe of total loonies.
Any questions? Roared Gobber.
Hiccup put up his hand. A small point, sir. Won't we freeze to death in about 5 minutes?
Don't be a softy, roared Gobber. The blubberwing fat you have rubbed all over you should keep you warm enough to prevent actual death. But it's all part of the game, of course. Can you use your skill and judgment to stay out long enough to win the race, but not so long that you freeze to death?
Gobber walked up and down the line of boys, inspecting them before they went out to join the competition.
Very smart, Snotlout. Chin up, Toughnut Junior.
Haven't you forgotten something, Clueless?
I've got my sword, sir, said Clueless.
You do have your sword, admitted Gobber. But you do not have your swimming costume. Put it on quick, boy. I don't think that Thor will be well.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.